Toxic Baby, next on Enviro Close Up. Welcome to Enviro Close Up. I am Carl Grossman with Penelope Jagessar Chaffer. She's the first black woman to be nominated for the British Academy Award, and that was for her first documentary, Me and My Dad. Now this London-born filmmaker, she's out with a new documentary, Toxic Baby, and it's about the thousands of chemicals that our children are exposed to. Welcome, Penelope.
Thank you.
Penelope, how did you decide to begin this big project, Toxic Baby?
Well, when I found out that the amount of chemicals that our children are exposed to and what science was showing, this was now 8 years ago, in terms of contaminating a baby and the effects, the health effects that would be shown, I just thought, it just felt weird that I didn't really know that much about it. It's not something that's readily discussed in the press. And so I wanted to find out some more. So I started doing a bit of research, and what I found out really astounded me. And so the point of making Toxic Baby was really to take the science from the scientists and really expose it to a wider audience so that parents would have the ability to make informed decisions based on what the science was saying and not what they were marketed to.
Now, you're the mother of two, so I mean, you've got a big personal stake in this issue. How did that figure into this?
Well, I became aware of the seriousness of the issue when I took my son to a birthday party and I met a breast cancer survivor who had a young daughter. And she told me that she'd found out that the group of preservative chemicals that's the most widely used in baby care products had been found in breast cancer tumors and had the ability to mimic estrogen. And so she was going around this birthday party literally saying to all the moms there, you know, don't use these parabens. And I was just astounded, Carl, because as far as I was concerned, you know, I'd read every book that there had ever been published on pregnancy. I'd never heard anything about this. And truthfully, I thought perhaps it was some sort of internet hoax or something like that. And it didn't take very long for me to realize that this was a very well-researched study that had been published in a reputable journal. And so that was the beginning of a really uncomfortable awakening that the parabens were just actually the tip of the iceberg. And that, as you said, you know, we're looking at thousands of chemicals that have the ability to affect children in ways that we're only now really beginning to understand. And not just our children, but their children and possibly, you know, even further generations from that.
Now, in Toxic Baby, what you've done is to stress scientists and science. Why? What was the strategy for the documentary?
Well, I felt, first of all, that parents had a right to know what scientists were finding out. I felt like that information wasn't really being communicated in the wider press. And I also felt that as a mother, you know, I feel compelled to protect my children, and I can't do that if I don't have that information. So really, I had three choices, I guess, when I first found out. I could have told no one, but made all the changes in my own life. Or I could have told perhaps a small coterie of friends and relatives. Or I could just tell absolutely everyone that I came across about this. And I felt that, you know, people needed to know. So for me as a filmmaker, that was the best way I could find of disseminating the scientific information. And I think, you know, it's great speaking to the scientists, because some of these scientists have been doing these studies for a long time, and some of them have been really vilified. You know, the first early studies that started coming out, they had a lot of attacks on their reputation, you know, questioning the veracity and the validity of their work. And so it was very important for me to focus on the science, because I think if science is showing something that can be measured, then we need to concentrate on that and not be distracted by what the marketing says or what the politicians say or, you know, even some of the environmental advocates, you know, give the scientists the forum to be able to say, this is what my study has shown. You know, you have the ability to make a choice that's informed. So, you know, that's why the focus on the science.
Discuss with us what some of these scientists say in Toxic Baby.
You know, it was shocking as a mother to speak to these scientists, and it was heartbreaking in a way, because they were finding significant effects with their laboratory studies for animals. So we see how, for example, in tests with frogs, how the herbicide atrazine has the ability to shift the gender of the frogs. I mean, you know, actual sexual gender. So male frogs became female. They had less interest in mating. They would actually develop eggs in their testes when exposed to atrazine. And atrazine is a widely used herbicide here in the United States. I had a scientist showing how she found high levels of phthalates, which are plasticizers, after children had been exposed to certain baby care products, baby shampoo, baby powder. They would see a spike in the urine of the children, and they would go back and see, well, what was used and at what time was it used, and they surmised that it was coming from this route. So the scientists are talking about things that are not, they're not random abstract thought. They're things that they could clearly measure. They show how, again, with phthalates, how if you expose a mother rat to phthalates, you see effects for male pups, their genitalia, and the development of that genitalia. And then you see the parallel with young boys being born and some of the birth defects that are really on the rise, like hypospadias, which is that deformity of the penis where the urethra is not where it should be, it's somewhere else. Cryptorchidism, where the testicles are not present at birth, they've not descended yet. And those defects, those disorders, are risk factors for things like testicular germ cell cancer that happen later on in life. So for the scientists to be able to see these effects with laboratory animals and then see this very interesting, well, it's not interesting, perhaps that's not the best word, but to see this rise in a lot of the childhood, chronic childhood diseases that we see. You know, somebody started asking questions and they slowly started piecing these things together. And so when they're seeing these things in the lab and then you're seeing it in real life, it's sort of disheartening for them as well. You know, some of the scientists are older scientists and they talk about how, you know, they're seeing sort of like this third generation now for a drug like DES, a chemical like DES, that was used widely up until the early 1970s to prevent miscarriage. And the daughters that were exposed in the womb, whose mothers were given this drug, had extraordinarily high rates of very rare cancers, upper uterine cancers, vaginal cancers, early in life. These are things that that are exceptionally rare, but the daughters were having them at a rate that people couldn't work out why. And you know, for this particular scientist, he's now seeing the grandchildren of those mothers who were originally given the drug back in the 1950s and the 1960s and so forth. And they're now seeing effects on the granddaughters. So, you know, I think for them, it's been such an interesting sort of time for their work to be coming through, because the volume of science that's coming out now really validates those early thoughts when they were seeing these results and they were saying, these are going to show up somewhere else. You know, there's a reason why we use these laboratory animals as models, and if we're seeing it here, we're probably going to start seeing it elsewhere.
You interview and find independent scientists.
Yeah.
How did you find them?
It's a good question. And you know, it's interesting for me because as a journalist, as a filmmaker, you want the people who are best able to discuss what's being talked about, but you need people who don't have or don't appear to have some sort of conflict or some sort of vested interest in certain results. And what I found was that it was a small club that's gradually getting wider and wider, but they were a core group of people who were really following the science. And it was a little bit like a secret society. So I had to get one scientist to agree. And only when that one scientist agreed, the scientist whose door I've been knocking on for ages, then they said, okay, well, we've spoken to her and we can vouch for her. And it was very much sort of like picking through the science and really trying to find the best examples of these studies, and also the scientists who were really able to sort of communicate that. I mean, scientists often work in groups, so it was finding the lead scientists from studies and asking other scientists, we want to talk about this, who would you recommend? And they were like, oh, so-and-so is an absolute expert on this. And, some of them are relatively well-known in their field, and others are more obscure. They're not in it for the glory. They're certainly not that well-known. So coaxing them out of the laboratory and onto film was an interesting process in itself.
Now, in researching for Toxic Baby and listening to these scientists and learning about this, frankly, nightmarish situation, I mean, this is affecting our children in the most serious of ways. Do you think the government, on kind of any level, is protecting us?
Here in the United States, I don't think that the government is across this in the way that people expect. And I think that because of the lack of legislation that has occurred in this issue, certainly the lack of regulation that exists with regards to chemicals and their manufacture, I think that, the government really is on the back foot with this issue. We're now trying to get legislation going that will look at environmental chemicals and how they have this capability to affect human health. But I think that for too long, the government, for many years, was not involved in the way that people think. People have, when I speak to people all the time, they have this assumption that, well, this couldn't be happening. The government wouldn't allow it, or there must be rules and regulations that would prevent this kind of thing happening. And it feels a lot like the Wild West, the manufacture of chemicals, the volume of chemicals. I mean, here in the United States, the statistic is the United States imports or manufactures millions of pounds of chemicals every day, millions. That's an inordinate amount of volume. The volume of those chemicals that eventually will end up in our environments and end up in our bodies. In the film, I talk about internal environmentalism because of the fact that this is our environments. And that sheer volume of chemical matter that has the ability to interact with our bodily systems, I think it's astonishing. And I think when you look at some of these figures, the number is over 80,000 chemicals in widespread circulation here in the US. In Europe, it's a little bit more, over 100,000. People are just, I think, beyond blown away by just the sheer quantity of what we're talking about, and the idea that one of these chemicals could potentially have these effects. Two of these chemicals, or what are the effects of two of these chemicals together? And you only have to look at the back of a product and see the long list of ingredients. Well, what's happening when all of those chemicals get together and combine? And that's one of the things we talk about in the film, is this concept of the chemical cocktail, of how these things can come together. And interestingly, what science is now showing is that if you take a low dose of one chemical, very low dose, and then you take a low dose of another chemical, even chemicals from within the same family or chemicals from outside that chemical group, that you see effects as if it were one really large exposure of a single chemical. So for a long time, we were told, well, you don't need to worry about these exposures because, there's such little amounts that we're talking about that traditionally people would expose rats to, a very high dose and they would see these effects. And the rebuttal was, well, actually, in day-to-day life, nobody's exposed to that high level. And for a long time, that was the argument that was used to really limit the amount of interest, limit the amount of government involvement in this. And what scientists began to do was they started saying, okay, well, let's take small doses, the kind that people would be exposed to, but then let's add it to this other chemical and this other chemical. And quite frankly, science cannot keep up. It's inordinately expensive to test one chemical. I think it's impossible to test every single chemical and every single possible interaction. So I think that's when people feel extraordinarily overwhelmed, when they start understanding the amount that we're talking about and how every single product that you bring into your home that your child's exposed to will contain chemicals of great concern. You know, there's a real sort of sense of, oh my God, you know, and how come we don't know about this and why are we not protected?
And the EPA, though it was required to, this goes back to the 70s, analyze the tens of thousands of chemicals, now it's 80,000, as you say. I mean, the EPA analyzed a tiny fraction of the 80,000.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, it's, with the benefit of hindsight, it's an interesting situation. You know, when TSCA came in, Toxic Substances Control Act, most of the chemicals, if not all of the chemicals, were the term is grandfathered in. So they were brought into TSCA without having these checks and balances put into place. It was like, okay, moving forward, we would like new chemicals to go through these process, but we won't actually look at any of the chemicals that we have in circulation up until that point. I mean, I think clearly that was flawed. I think, but also moving forward, it would appear that the EPA really didn't have or maybe they weren't given the muscle to be able to really go after these things. I mean, you only have to look at asbestos and the absolute farce of the EPA trying to ban asbestos, you know, a chemical that's widely known for its extremely harmful effects. It's widely banned across the EU and in other places, but you know, the EPA wasn't even able to do that. And you can get very clear evidence to show the effects of asbestos. So I think that we can look back and we can see how it really went fundamentally wrong. And moving forward, we can only look at how we can learn from those lessons and really bring legislation and also, I think, a shift in culture, a shift in the way that we manufacture products. And as a consumer, our expectation of what these products can do and how we interact with them so that we don't make these awful decisions and make the mistakes of the past, and we can learn from them and really make changes. Because, you know, as I'm saying, we're looking at the effects of not just one generation or two generations, you know, further generations. If we don't bring in these pieces of legislation and this regulation now, and this continues, I mean, anywhere from 2,000 to 3,000 to 4,000 new chemicals are brought onto market every year. You know, in 10 years' time, potentially that is a significant amount of chemicals with really few checks and balances. Then no one's required to produce significant research on what the long-term effects of these chemicals might be, particularly on children's developing organ systems, because often, you know, the sense is, well, for an adult, it's fine. Well, you know, children are not little adults. They are going through very precise developmental changes that need to happen at certain times. And what we've now come to realize is that chemicals have the ability to interfere with those developmental processes that have long-term implications for their health.
A two-parter. A couple starting a family, having children. What's the couple to do under these circumstances? And the second part, that's micro and macro here, what type of legislation, what type of governmental action do you think is necessary?
Okay, so that's a great question. What is it that people can do? I think potential parents have to understand that having children's not quite like going out and buying a sofa. You know, I think for a lot of people, I want to have a baby and I just go out and have a baby. If you look at the Dutch, they're a great example. Over 75% of all Dutch births are planned. And the Dutch scientists that I spoke to, who are doctors who I spoke to, who are very across this issue, they advise their patients to plan their pregnancies, to not think about, I want to get pregnant right now, to think about, okay, well, let's give it a certain amount of time. And in that time, let's try and reduce the kind of exposures that could cause harm to a developing fetus. Unfortunately, a lot of this does fall on the mother, but science is also showing that male sperm genetically can be affected by toxic chemical exposure. So it's really for both parties. But of course, you know, the mother carries the child, and that is the environment within which the baby's going to grow in. So what they need to do is they really need to look at what they're bringing into the home, what that child is going to take in when the mother breathes in air or eats certain food or drinks certain things, applies certain things to her skin. The home is the first place that you look for, and you think about, well, what am I bringing into the home? How am I scenting my home? What sort of cleaning products am I using in the home? You know, those are very clear exposures that we can actually avoid. They are very good alternatives. It makes me think very nostalgically about my grandmother and women of her age when I think about the things that we need to do in the home. You know, all of these great products were invented to make us so modern. And, you know, I remember the ads when I was growing up with you know, you wiped a surface and it gleamed and it had those sparkly stars and it was so amazing. And, you know, I remember my grandmother, you know, scrubbing the floor, and it wasn't considered very modern to be able to do that, and, you know, making their own you know, cleaning products and that kind of thing. But I think, you know, really we need to start thinking about moving away from, you know, just consuming and bringing things in and not really knowing what they can possibly do. I think food is very important, you know, eating organically and trying to stay away from pesticide exposure that can be found throughout our food chain, I think is very important. A lot of these pesticides have the ability to bioaccumulate, so they have the ability to go into the body and stay there and then obviously be passed on to the developing child. You know, parents often get pregnant and then they said, oh, quick, we'll renovate a room and build a nursery. And that kind of thing really shouldn't be done when there's a pregnant woman in the house. So if you're planning your child, you have the ability to think ahead and to do some research and to try and minimize some of those exposures. I mean, you know, there are children who have significant brain damage because they've been exposed to lead, because their parents have renovated a room in an older home and exposed the fetus to lead dust. So really, it is about thinking ahead. So we're in a really unusual situation here in the United States, where many of our trading partners, particularly within the EU, have stricter legislation than what we currently have. So we're in a position where American multinationals are shipping less toxic versions of their products abroad while still selling the original, more toxic product here at home. Now, clearly that's ridiculous. They've reformulated them, they've repackaged them, and the reason why they can do that is because there's not that legislation here. We have a piece of legislation called the Safe Chemicals Act that has been trying to be brought forward for the past couple of years, and I think it's something that would really look at the concerns with these chemicals. It would require new chemicals to be tested before being brought onto market, because we are in a situation now where, oh, this chemical's toxic, okay, well, let's replace it with another chemical 5 years later. Well, guess what? That chemical can be as toxic as the original one. So how we look at new chemicals, how do we assess the hazardous properties of the existing chemicals, and what do we do about them? So I think legislation really needs to look at that, and Safe Chemicals Act is a great piece of legislation which, moving forward in 2013 and onwards, we'll need strong public support to get it passed.
Do you smell change being in the air?
I do smell change being in the air. And I think, you know, in the journey that I've taken to make this film, which has been, you know, many years now, it's 8 years now that I've been directly working on this issue, I think what has happened, well, there are several things that have happened. One is technology has allowed scientists to test in much more minute quantities. And also there's a lot more money that's now being pumped into this testing because of greater awareness and because of the science that was already there. So what we're seeing is more science coming through, and it feels almost like an avalanche of science at this point. Unfortunately, it comes with an avalanche of concerns because what the science is showing is very concerning. But what it means is that we're beginning to have that public awareness that would allow us to be able to really look at how we do this as a population at large.
And you talked about Europe kind of being in another world in regards to these poisons.
They are further down the road than the US is. Their legislation is called REACH. And REACH was something that was brought in 2005. So it's not that long-standing. But I guess what the EU has and what the advantage that they have is that it's a group of countries coming together. And one country might be a little bit more environmentally minded than the other, but because of the participation of that country, they are able to have that dialogue. I think environmental concerns are, I guess, relatively new for a lot of the American population. And so this is new stuff for the average person out there who's, they've got their 2.3 kids and their car, and they do their work, and this is something that seems like a really bad nightmare. But I think that, because we have Europe doing what it's doing and moving ahead with that, because it's such a huge economic link to the United States, that their legislation sort of informs potentially how our legislation could work. So the Americans are actually in a great place where they can see a piece of legislation that is working and how it's been implemented, and they can do something that takes the best of that legislation and really build on that.
And the status of Toxic Baby now in terms of a film project?
Well, for a long time, I struggled with Toxic Baby because people really just didn't believe the science. They didn't believe it was credible. But when I read the scientific studies and I spoke to the scientists, it was clear that they were really onto something. And I think now, 8 years later, we're seeing this groundswell of interest. And when you have the New York Times reporting as often as it does, the Wall Street Journal, USA Today, NBC, ABC, and all of these news outlets, almost on a weekly basis, talking about some new piece of research or some study, I think it brings us to a place where a film like Toxic Baby can find a home. So we're in the process of working out what's the best way for the film to support the Safe Chemicals Act, because I think that that's hugely important in 2013. But also the best way to get that information out to parents in particular in a digital world that doesn't necessarily have to rely on more traditional forms of distribution.
We've been hearing from Penelope Jagessar Chaffer about her film project, Toxic Baby. To learn more about Toxic Baby, just visit the website, toxicbaby.com. Thank you so much, Penelope, for your work. To learn more about the series of Enviro close-up shows that we do, just visit our website at EnviroVideo.com. I'm Carl Grossman, and thank you for watching.